Get up and go.
Our chairs are literally killing us.
And you'll be glad you did.
A true sense of happiness.
Hear why we're made to move.
The most important thing, the data are very clear.
On today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Good morning and welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Whether you're running, you're walking, or gardening, it's all good. Regardless of what you do, regular exercise and physical activity is the way to go, not only to health and well-being, but also to ward off sickness.
Well, all week we've been showing you ways to strengthen your immune system. And today's topic, exercise, one of my favorites, is one of the best things you can do for your body. And here is Gordon Robertson to start us out.
Exercise, it's in our DNA. We are made to move, and movement keeps your immune system functioning at peak performance. Unfortunately, only about half of us exercise regularly, which is a problem, because scientists now tell us that sitting is the new smoking. Dr. James Levine is an endocrinologist at the world-famous Mayo Clinic. He spent the last 15 years researching what a sedentary lifestyle does to the body.
What's become clear over the last decade is that our chairs are literally killing us. Excessive sitting is shaving, knocking, taking years off our lives.
People who don't exercise get sick more often than people who do. In fact, when inactive people were compared to those who walked briskly almost every day, those who didn't walk took twice as many sick days in 4 months as those who did. Exercise increases blood flow, which helps expel toxic waste from the body. That also means disease-fighting antibodies and immune-boosting white blood cells will move through the body faster. That way, they can detect and kill infections sooner.
If we can help people get out of their chairs, not only are the rewards the reversal of all these catastrophic health problems, but a true sense of happiness.
Exercise also helps you sleep better, which improves your ability to fight infection.
In order to reap the benefits of exercise, you need consistency. For many of us, that means first thing in the morning. Just make sure you choose an activity you enjoy.
That is the most important thing. The data are very clear. If you encourage people to do things they hate, guess what? They won't do it.
If you're struggling to find an exercise you like, then work out with people you like. It might not be the exercise, but the friendships that keep you coming back for more. And as a bonus, they'll hold you accountable. So get a walking buddy or attend a group exercise class. For some people, exercising in water works best. That's because we feel much lighter in the pool. In fact, water's buoyancy displaces 85% of our body weight. That makes it easier and less painful.
Many people have actual arthritis where the joints themselves are being damaged. But in addition to that, and it is actually very poorly reported, many of my patients with excess body weight, many of my patients battling with obesity actually have early arthritis called arthropathy, where the joints have started to see damage, but not on the x-ray. And for all of these patients, and for those with diabetes who really are unable to do exertional exercise, the swimming pool is an oasis of joy.
Keep your workouts moderate. High-intensity training can decrease the amount of white blood cells circulating through the body and actually increase your risk of illness.
Some people can't or don't want to carve out time just for exercise. They'd rather multitask and exercise while they work.
Dr. Levine came up with the idea for a treadmill desk 10 years ago. Today, tens of thousands of employees from coast to coast are discovering the benefits of walking while they work.
I think that's really awesome to be able to say, while you accomplish your work, you also walk X amount of miles.
New research shows we all need some exercise at the office, even if we work out later at the gym. That's because sitting for prolonged periods of time causes our bodies to shut down. So if you have a desk job, think of ways to move. It doesn't have to involve a treadmill desk. You can walk over and talk face to face instead of sending an email. Use the restroom on the far side of the building. Take a lap or two around your work area every hour. And Dr. Levine's favorite, walk and talk meetings.
When we have deployed walking-based programs in the workplace, and it's not just treadmill desks, it's walk and talk meetings, active workplaces, what others have noticed, and ourselves, is that sick days from employees diminish. People appear to get less coughs, less colds, and less days off work.
Even if you're not walking, simply standing at your desk is better than sitting. Research shows that even while standing, we move around.
And what appears to be the case is once you're off your bottom, great things happen. Once you get up, the future is yours.
So whether it's the gym, home, or office, you'll fight disease and feel great doing it.
Just want to say, if I did some of those exercises, I'd be on my bottom.
I love that, though, Terry, that he says, look, if you don't want the exercise, if you're not looking for the exercise, find a buddy you like, find a friend you like, make it fun. We tend to think the exercise regime has to be such a punishment.
I do that, not as often as I should, but I have a person that I work with, and I go over to her house after her kids are in bed and my dishes have been cleaned up, and we walk and do business and get our exercise in and go to bed guilt-free.
Yeah, and I've been in different seasons in my life. I'm exercising regularly, then I'm not, and then I'm back on and off. And truly, though, when we're exercising and moving about, it makes an enormous difference on our outlook on life and our confidence
level. I agree. I think you do have a more positive feeling about life because you feel better about yourself.
How do you like the treadmill desk?
I have trouble watching scrolling on the screen, so actually walking and moving, maybe not so much.
We'll transition to that slowly.
Okay, great. That's a deal. Well, this is the last part of our 5-part series called Protect Your Health, and we hope that you've enjoyed it. It's had lots of wonderful information. If you happen to have missed an episode, don't worry about that. Just call the number on your screen. We are happy to send you this brand new DVD with all 5 parts, and here's the good news, it's free of charge. And if you give to CBN via Pledge Express, by the way, if you're already a member, you'll get it automatically, so just watch for it in your mailbox. And don't forget that you can also watch the series online by going to cbn.com.
Thank you, Terry. Well, coming up, we'll have your questions on health and exercise. But first, she's 77 years old and giving us all a run for our money.
I want to see how far and how long I can keep up the running. Age is nothing but a number. You can get fit at any age.
Wow, is she inspirational? This 2010 Guinness World Record holder is next, and you don't want to miss her inspiring story. Stay with us.
No more excuses for any of us. After you see one of the world's oldest female bodybuilders, you'll realize it is possible to be fit at any age, and you're never too old to start. Ernestine Shepherd was 56 when she got started, and take a look at her now.
The face of this bodybuilding sensation has graced the pages of the Guinness Book of World Records. At 74, Ernestine Shepherd has earned a place in history as the world's oldest female bodybuilder.
Now that you've reached your goal, how do you feel?
It feels great. I'm so proud of being in the Guinness Book of World Records.
Look at these biceps. How much do you bench press?
I can bench press 150 pounds.
Ernestine, or Ernie as she likes to be called, didn't even step foot into the gym until she was 56. Now, 20 years later, the bodybuilding champ is in the best shape of her life.
Age is nothing but a number. You can get fit at any age. I feel so much better now in my 70s than I did in my 40s.
In 2008, she entered her first bodybuilding competition and took home a winning trophy. She maintains her sculpted physique with the help of her trainer, Yanni Schamberger, a former Mr. Universe. And she does it without steroids or any other medication.
You can be a bodybuilder. You do not have to take a lot of supplements. You can do it naturally, and you can look good.
But Ernie, who's also a model, wants more than just a chiseled body and six-pack abs.
The mission that I'm on, and I call it a mission, is to help and to try to inspire and motivate people on the importance of being fit. God has placed that in my heart to do this work.
Ernie doubles as a personal trainer and fitness instructor at Energy Fitness Center in Randallstown, Maryland. And she holds weekly classes at her church in nearby Baltimore. Wherever she goes, she inspires people of all ages to live healthier lives without limits.
She looks great. And all of us, I don't know any woman who doesn't want to look good in their clothes and feel great, and she is a perfect example of that.
It's like crazy the fact that she's, not to be mean, but like older, and she's like still weight training, and she has a really good body. And it's like, it's wow.
After 37-year-old Avon Carroll hired Ernie to be his trainer, he lost 40 pounds.
When you see somebody 74 years old that can outrun you, that can do more reps than you, you know, that has that much energy, you realize it's not too late.
That's it.
I always say you need to be determined, dedicated, disciplined to be fit.
For Ernie, health and fitness begins with her relationship with Jesus Christ.
Each morning I awaken at 3 o'clock. Before I do anything, I have my morning devotions because I have to thank God for what He's done for me. Prayer is so important. All the exercising in the world is not going to help if you don't pray about it. And God is so good, and I can say that I truly, truly love the Lord.
After prayer, Ernie hits the pavement at 4 a.m. for her daily 10-mile run, and she loves running marathons.
Exercise is fun for me because here I am, 74 years old, or should I say young, and it's fun. I want to see how far and how long I can keep up the running. If I had it in my mind that it was work, I really wouldn't want to do it.
At home, Ernie sticks to a strict high-protein diet, which includes 3 glasses of raw egg whites a day. Collins, her husband of 53 years, helps prepare her special meals.
My wife is truly amazing. She's quite an inspiration to me, and she is one of a kind.
As long as I am healthy, I will continue doing this. I really want to help as many people as I can to let them know, don't let life pass you by. You can be fit. And then also, to let them know that God loves them too. What He has done for me, He will do for them too.
She is an inspiration. This is just tea, not egg whites, but my heart's with her. Ernestine has since passed her title as the world's oldest performing female bodybuilder to 77-year-old Edith Wilma Connor from Denver, Colorado.
And how about Ernestine with her 3 a.m. wake up and devotions and then the 10-mile run? I mean, wow.
I mean, some nights I'm going to bed then, you know what I'm saying?
So she's a physical inspiration, and then spiritually she's got her act together too.
Wow, she's a disciplined lady. Well, she said that's what you need, determination, discipline, and I forget what the third one was.
Fantastic story, fantastic. Another inspiration of health and exercise is 96-year-old Tao Porshawn Lynch from White Plains, New York. She's the world's oldest yoga teacher. Goes to show you, Terry, we're never too old to exercise. You're inspired now, aren't you?
Well, yes, I'm inspired for them. Yeah. And I'd like to be inspired for me. No, it is impressive. I think it's something we all should be doing some part of. You know, I can't do the 3 a.m. with the
egg whites. That is a touch early.
Yeah. Well, we've had lots of questions come in about health and exercise. I think everybody's concerned about it or recognizes the need for it. So let's go over to Jessica and chat. Hi, Jess.
Well, Terry, we've got some questions in. Tiffany says, I want to work out and be healthy. I see these older people in shape like Ernestine, and it makes me ashamed that I'm so out of shape. How do I even begin, Terry?
Well, Tiffany, I'm right there with you. I just want to say, I think that one of the things that's key to this is you have to have a plan. You have to have a plan. Good intentions are just like wishes in the wind. They will not do it for you. And I find in my life, whether I'm fasting for something or wanting to get into shape, wanting to lose weight, needing to work out, you have to have a plan. You have to have a time that you're going to do it. You have to have everything you need to do it available to you. You know, too often we say, well, I'm going to work at eating healthy, but we don't really get rid of the junk in our house and buy the stuff that's good. And we're not purposed enough in it. That's the determination part, I think, that you've got to almost, for a season of time anyway, make that a focal point in your life. And that's the discipline that she talks about.
Make a great point, too. What you have in your house makes a huge difference.
Oh,
what are you eating? What are you snacking on?
Mm-hmm. And having the good stuff available, you know, and not running out of it. Because I don't know about you, Tiffany, but sometimes, like, I come home from work, I'm hungry at that point, or I have a mid-afternoon slump, and I'll go for the easiest thing that there is to grab. So you need to make sure that the easiest thing is something good.
And if you don't have it in your house, it's not there to grab.
That's exactly right.
Okay. Jessica, what else we have?
Well, Andrew, Chris says, I used to exercise and be in great shape. I could outlast and outdo most of my buddies at the gym. But recently, I find myself being lazy, gaining weight, and sometimes feeling depressed with no ambition. How do you get out of a funk? Andrew, what do you think about that?
Chris, you certainly know the answer to this because you said you used to be in good shape and be able to outlift and exercise a lot of your buddies. It seems to me that you know the best way out of a funk is to acknowledge you're in it, acknowledge the reality you're living in, and then just, as Terry mentioned earlier, stop talking about it, stop thinking about it, make a plan, get up and go, put on your tennis shoes or your sneakers, whatever you're calling them, and next time you're laying there feeling lethargic, just go outside, walk for 10 minutes, you're out of your funk, you're feeling better, and of course, Terry, it's starting that routine. Sometimes getting it started is the hardest part.
I was just going to say that. Just do start with a reasonable amount. Like, you don't have to go back to where you were when you were on top of your game. Like, start with something reasonable and work out of, you know, that place and go to the next level and then the next level. Pretty soon, you're back where you were. I mean, if you were there before, you've got it together, you can do it again. So be encouraged, just getting started. Key deal, you know. Still ahead, overweight and ashamed.
After some time goes on, they walk up to me and they tell me that I'm too big to ride on this ride. That was just devastating, very embarrassing to me.
How this man dropped 150 pounds in a year without drugs or surgery. Plus, we're going to be praying for you and your needs. Stay with us. We'll be back. It's all next.
Your goal is to lose weight, but you don't know where to start. We're about to show you a story that will inspire you. At 350 pounds, Nick Serta was too big to ride a roller coaster, exercise, or even play with his children. But in just 1 year, he lost 150 pounds. Here's how he did it.
I took a group of kids, students, to an amusement park, and we're there on the roller coaster, and we're getting strapped in, and there's something that's keeping us from taking off on this roller coaster, and the guys at the booth, the control booth, are trying to figure it out, and they're kind of talking back and forth, and I have no idea what's going on, and they, after some time goes on, they walk up to me and they tell me that I'm too big to ride on this ride and the safety restraint couldn't come down far enough. That was just devastating, very embarrassing to me.
At 350 pounds, riding roller coasters wasn't the only thing Nick Serta couldn't do.
I couldn't run at all without being out of breath, and I couldn't play with our child, our son at the time. I mean, I would play with him, but I always was tired. And since I had a weight problem my whole adult life, I just assumed that was life.
If fatigue wasn't a big enough clue that Nick needed to take off the weight, his body size should have been. But it wasn't.
Every time I saw pictures of myself or saw my reflection, there's something inside of me that didn't like what it saw, but not enough that it bothered me to do something about it. I found food as a source of, you know, feeling good, and if I got stressed out, even as a kid, I would turn to food for comfort.
Then Nick got a wake-up call. He had hurt his wrist and went to see a doctor. Doctor told him his wrist wasn't the problem.
Rather than diagnosing my wrist problem, she just looked at me and said, "You're overweight to the point that it's dangerous." Then that conversation showed me how far I had let the problem go.
Nick decided it was time to do something. His wife Heather suggested that the entire family develop healthier eating habits. They began eating whole grains and lean proteins. It was just what Nick needed to jumpstart his new endeavor. Little by little, the weight came off.
My first goal was to get down under 300. And I just told myself, you know, that would be a starting goal to get under 300. Then as I crept closer to 300, then I was like, well, how about 250?
He also began to exercise.
And it was simple as just walking. I'd stick on shoes and clothes and just go for a walk. I would set a goal, I'd complete the goal. And right as I was about to complete that goal, I'd set a new goal. And constantly setting those smaller goals got me here.
He says God helped him stick to his plan.
One thing that really motivated me, particularly as, you know, I would stall sometimes and the pounds dropping off, they weren't coming off as quickly. I didn't want to get up and go to the gym, was just knowing my identity in Jesus Christ. And it says in the scriptures, you know, God has called you and he is faithful and he will do it.
As the weight came off, Nick began to make other goals for himself, like running a 5K race.
It was painful. It wasn't a real enjoyable process.
He kept at it and now runs 25 to 30 miles a week. More importantly, he now weighs only 199 pounds. That's over 150 pounds of weight loss.
So I feel just empowered now to even speak greater about discipline. And it is a spiritual issue with food. Food is not our crutch. Food is not our comfort. That's God's alone. That's God's place.
Nick, way to go. We rejoice in your accomplishment and how you're feeling about yourself and the improvement in your health. And this is a very important topic. We've had lots of prayer requests come into our Facebook page about losing weight. Over 75% of the post asked for specific prayer on being overweight. We want to pray for all of you, so let's go back over to Jessica.
Well, Andrew, we've got some prayer requests in. Alan says, "I recently gained a lot of weight. I'm not happy about it and want to lose it, but I'm having a hard time motivating myself. It is causing problems in my marriage and with my health. Please pray for the motivation and the strength to get myself healthier." Terry says, "Please pray for me and my three children. We are all overweight and need to lose it and keep it off. I really want us to be healthy, strong, and a healthy, strong family." Well, if you are watching and you say, "Hey, that's me. I've been watching this and I feel convicted and I need to get in better shape," well, join with us in prayer. Well, Lord, I don't think there's one of us watching who says, "Father, there are changes that I need to make to be healthier, to be a better example." And Lord, we just lift up Alan and Terry. And Father, we ask you to just heal their bodies, that you would just come and heal their marriages. Lord, we ask that you would come and give us the discipline, just like Nick in that previous story, to set small, achievable goals, Father, so that we can get on the right track towards health and towards a healthy lifestyle that we can pass on to our kids. And Father, we just ask for your divine intervention to help us do what we cannot do, to get off of crutches like food and other things, deal with any root pain problems like depression that could be holding us back from motivation. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Terry?
You know, Nick said something that I think was really powerful at the end of that. He said, "Food is not our crutch or our comfort. That is God's place." That's
powerful.
Boy, that kind of puts it all in perspective, doesn't it? That is God's place. Well, we want to show you one more inspirational story, this one about an 87-year-old grandmother who plays ball with their grandkids and even takes aerobic classes. She credits her good health and energy to a greenhouse project sponsored by CBN.
Grandma Sutsibi is an 87-year-old inspiration. Unlike most people her age, she's still very active. She takes long walks and even plays games.
"I used to feel very weak all the time."
But her orphaned grandchildren needed her.
"Without me, they would have needed a miracle from God just to survive."
She wasn't getting proper nutrition, and it was taking a toll on her body.
I lived on a small grant from the government and tried to buy vegetables when I could. But the money always ran out. We begged neighbors for anything they could give us.
Then CBN gave greenhouses to a local church. Every week, people like Grandma Sutsibi get fresh, nutritious vegetables for their families.
I can feed everyone at home and still have vegetables left over. Now that I eat these vegetables, I feel very, very strong. Nothing can match the food I get here.
At the church, she started attending prayer meetings sponsored by CBN. Then she and the other ladies in the group decided to start an aerobics class. Doctors can't believe how well she's doing now, but she has an explanation.
I was old before, but now I am young.
The combination of good food, exercise, and the Word of God has given Grandma Sutsibi a renewed mind, body, and spirit.
I am young enough to play with my grandchildren. As a child, I had dolls, and now they are my dolls to play with.
Thank you, CBN.
Making a difference in the lives of people around the world. 700 Club members do that every day. Join us. Call our number, 1-888-777-1999. Just say, I want to join the 700 Club. Andrew?
Inspirational show today. We have seen some great stories about people just tackling the issue and saying, I'm going to do something about it. I don't care how old I am, I'm going to do it. And we'll leave you today with these words from 1 Timothy chapter 4. Physical training is good, but training for godliness is much better, promising benefits in this life and in the life to come. A great reminder that we do not forget our spiritual well-being and seeking the Lord and having our spiritual life under control and disciplined as well, not only our physical bodies. For Jessica and Terry Musin, I'm Andrew Knox. We'll see you tomorrow on 700 Club Interactive.